I have taught anthropology, and today I am here to discuss with you the strategy, or to clarify your doubts, as well as to tell you some do's and some don'ts while preparing for anthropology. So anthropology, basically, you must be knowing, or you must be having syllabus in your hands. If it's not in your hands, please go for its copy, either in the form of hard copy, or open it in your mobile phones. I will be showing it on the laptop, but you should have it in your hands also. So I'll go with the explanation of what is anthropology first of all, because many times you people may not know ki what anthropology is all about, and there are so many myths ki oba anthropology is to be preferred by biology students, or anthropology is only suitable for medicos, anthropology cannot be taken by arts graduates. So how much truth is there in these statements, or how much reliable these statements are? Everything we are going to discuss today. First of all, I'll explain you what is anthropology. So basically, anthropology is, simple words, is the study of human beings in totality. So what is study of human beings in totality? Means sagalyach aspects are human beings cha sagalyach aspects cha abhyas manje manav vanshashastra ya subject cha marathitla naav aahe. So anthropology basically integrates all the disciplines which are related to the study of human being. So suppose if I say medical science, or let us break it down, medical science includes the study of anatomy, physiology and biochemistry of human beings. So anatomy is nothing but the structure of body, physiology is nothing but the function of body, that is how human body functions, and biochemistry is nothing but the chemical composition of the human body. So human body madhe kutle components astat, and what are the elemental components, or what are the chemical components of different organs of the body. So that is studied in biochemistry. So this is one aspect, or this is one part of human study. Second is, suppose let us consider political science, a totally different subject, but still it is related to the human beings, or how they are politically organized, how leadership evolves, how the power emerges, how power is utilized, then what is authority, and all how human society is organized, how it remains organized. Okay, so animals also remain organized. They travel in groups, they live in groups. Human beings also do so, but human beings are a bit different than other animals. So what are those factors which govern the power, or what are those factors which give rise to power, what are those factors which determine or which govern the use of that power? So that is studied in political science. Economic studies, how economic behavior of human being is decided. For example, every one of you, and including me, are involved in some kind of economic transactions. So how economic transactions occur in our life. So how do we make economic decisions? Suppose if I am supposed to buy a pen, and if I tell you that I am going to give this pen or give this marker to you for 1 crore rupees, so will you buy it? No. But if I say I am going to give it to you for only 10 rupees, so probably you may run, because in market it costs around 25 to 35 rupees, and if it's 10 rupees you will run for it. So this is your rational decision. You know how much you should pay for what thing. So kutle kimtila kay vikat ghyaycha, you know. Okay, so that is your economic decision making, and how human beings make their economic decisions, that is studied in economics. Or how rationality is the basis of economic decision making, that is studied in economics. Psychology studies the psyche of human beings, how human beings think, how human beings behave with each other, how human beings deal with each other, and what is their psychology, what factors govern their behavior with each other. So behavioral study of human being is psychology. Then there are many other disciplines. History studies the past events in the human beings' lives. So all these are the things which are studied in different branches. All these are the things which are analyzed, interpreted in different branches and different disciplines. Anthropology is integration of all these disciplines. Anthropology is studied in an integrated manner. So suppose, for example, इकॉनॉमिक्सच्या विचारातून जर आपण असं कन्सिडर करा, तुम्ही असं रस्त्यावरती 100 रुपये टाकाल का? नाही टाकणार, कारण दॅट विल बी अ वेस्टेज ऑफ मनी. बट यू डोनेट इट ऑर यू गिव्ह इट व्हेरी कम्फर्टेबली इन अ टेम्पल. यू आर नॉट शुअर अबाउट, येस कम इन, यू आर नॉट शुअर अबाउट हाऊ इट इज गोइंग टू बी युज्ड अँड स्टील यू गिव्ह इट, यू डोनेट इट. सो व्हॉट इज द रिझन? बिकॉज इट इज युअर रिलिजियस feeling or religious belief that I am giving it for God. Okay. Sometimes you are selling the goods in your shop. Being a shopkeeper, you are selling the goods in your shop. You are supposed to sell those goods at some appropriate price. If some relative or some close friend or some close relative comes to your shop and he has no money, will you mind giving it free to that guy? No, you may give it freely, free of cost. So here, the decisions are not always based on rationality and economics che rules pratyek thikani apply hotilech asa nahi. So many other factors play role in your economic behavior or economic decision making. Rationality is left behind. Okay. Rationality means economic rationality is left behind. So what is the reason? So economics is not a separate discipline. Economics is intertwined in our political behavior, political life, psychological life, religious life, as well as all the other spheres of life. म्हणजे economics ही एक integrated system म्हणून जर study केली तर आपल्याला समजेल, otherwise आपल्याला ती पूर्ण समजणार नाही. In the same way, politics. Political science studies the political science as a separate branch or as an isolated system. But anthropology tries to integrate it with religion. So does religion play any role in politics? It is very easy to answer. It definitely plays. Does politics play any role in religion? Economics, does economics play any role in religion? I'll tell you a very interesting example. Do you know in Vedic times, cows were being sacrificed? So, cow sacrifice was very common ritual in earlier times. But later on, cow was being domesticated for material gains. Cow was being domesticated for material gains. Tichyapasun doodh milta, tichyapasun fertilizer milta, tichyapasun milnare male जे बुल्स किंवा बुलक्स आहेत किंवा ऑक्सेस आहेत, दे आर बीइंग यूज फॉर ॲग्रिकल्चरल प्रॅक्टिस, दॅट इज दे आर यूज एज ड्रॉट ॲनिमल्स. सो वेन यू रिअलाइज द इकॉनॉमिक वर्थ ऑर द फायनान्शियल वर्थ ऑफ दॅट पर्टिक्युलर ॲनिमल, देन वॉट डू यू डू? यू चेंज सम थिंग्स इन युअर ओन रिलिजन सो दॅट द काऊ विल बी प्रोटेक्टेड. Getting my point? So economics and religion are definitely intertwined. They affect each other. So anthropology tries to study everything in an integrated manner. So that is difference between political science and anthropology. That is difference between sociology and social anthropology. That is difference between economics and economic anthropology. So anthropology is integrated study of human beings. And which human beings? Not only today's human beings, not only Indian human beings, all the human beings on the earth at all times, that is not only in ancient but prehistoric times also. Manje sadharan 2.1 to 2.5 million years ago, first member of Homo genus was witnessed, that is Homo habilis. त्याच्यापेक्षाही अगोदरपासून, होमो हॅबिलिस कधीपासून आला, त्याच्या अगोदरपासून त्याचं सगळ्या गोष्टी, त्याच्या इकॉनॉमिक बिहेवियर, पॉलिटिकल बिहेवियर, रिलिजियस बिहेवियर, सगळ्या गोष्टी आजच्या मानवापर्यंत आणि सगळ्या कॉन्टिनेंट्समध्ये या स्टडी केल्या जातात. सो दॅट इज वाय अँथ्रोपॉलॉजी इज कॉल्ड ॲज द कम्प्लीट स्टडी ऑफ ह्युमन बिईंग ऑर स्टडी ऑफ ह्युमन बिईंग इन टोटॅलिटी. गॉट इट? सो दॅट्स वाय अँथ्रोपॉलॉजी इज कन्सिडर्ड ॲज द होल सायन्स ऑर द कम्प्लीट सायन्स ऑफ ह्युमन बिईंग. येस. Sorry? Okay, no problem. I'll continuously use English. And whatever I have used in Marathi, I have also used in English also. So don't worry, you have not missed anything. Okay. It is not just the structure and function of human body. So what is structure of human body? Study of structure of human body? It's anatomy. Function of human body? Physiology. It is not just the study of human evolution. Study of human evolution is called as paleontology. So paleontology is nothing but a part of anthropology. Paleontology is not anthropology. Paleontology is part of anthropology. It is not just the study of sociocultural aspect of human life. So sociocultural aspect of human life is studied in sociology or ethnology or archaeology. Archaeology and ethnology are two branches which study the culture of human beings. So culture of human beings, if it is studied in context of today's societies, it is called as ethnology. If it is studied in the context of extinct societies, then it is archaeology. So it is not just the sociocultural aspect of human life. Actually, all are included, all these studies are included in anthropology, but in isolation, this cannot be defined as anthropology, this cannot be called as anthropology, this cannot be called as anthropology, collectively, and even many more. I have included only 3 points. There are many other points which are covered in anthropology, which are noted down in anthropology, okay, which we have to study in anthropology, okay. So this is the subject, basically subject. Now come to what you have to study. Anthropology is a very vast subject then. You came across what is anthropology in previous slide. So this much of the syllabus is there, this much of the coverage of the subject is there. Then for your examination, what points are going to be covered and what points you have to study? So what do you have to study? So your syllabus is very well defined. Your syllabus has been given very neatly. There is no any ambiguity. What has to be read and what you are not supposed to read. So let us just decode your syllabus. So this list mentions, meaning, scope and development of anthropology as the first point in your syllabus. So these are basics for 1.1, 1.2 and 1.3. These are basics of anthropology. Meaning, scope and development of anthropology. Then relationship of anthropology with other disciplines. Which disciplines? So may it be social sciences, behavioral sciences, medical sciences, earth sciences and humanities. Okay. So how anthropology is related? I told you, anthropology is nothing but integration of all these disciplines, and they study human being in harmony with other disciplines, in harmony with all disciplines. So that's why anthropology is called as a complete science. But we have to study how it is related to other disciplines and why. What is the difference between historical studies and anthropological studies then? Okay, what is the difference? So, is anthropology a sub-branch of history? Is anthropology a specialization of history and other disciplines, of course? Is anthropology a specialized study or anthropology is a sub-study? So, anthropology, as far as a subject is concerned, anthropology is a very new subject. It is in a budding stage. It is in a very nascent stage. It is not at all in a neonatal stage, apan manu shakto. It is in a very neonatal stage. Even if it has included all the elements, it is not much developed till date. It is very recent subject. So, in terms of development, otherwise its origin can be found out in the times of Plato and Aristotle. But still, in terms of development, it has developed in recent, last century only. Last century or one and a half century. So that's why it is a budding subject. It is a neonatal subject in a neonatal stage. And it is continuously deriving or it is continuously borrowing the concepts, the content, as well as the subject matter, a general subject matter from all these disciplines, behavioral sciences still, life sciences are still, medical sciences are still, earth sciences are still, humanities are still. So every branch is contributing to the development of anthropology from a long time. Every branch is contributing to the anthropology. Okay, so that we have to study in basics. What is anthropology? How it is related to other disciplines? Main branches of anthropology, main branches are four: archaeological, physical, linguistic and sociocultural. So these are four branches. So this is basic, along with chapter 8. Chapter 8 is related to research methods in anthropology. So first three points, 1.1, 1.2, 1.3 and chapter 8 are related to basics of anthropology. Second thing, this 1.4, 1.5 and 1.6, these are related to specifically physical anthropology. So these are related to human evolution, then evolutionary stages of human beings, primates, what are primates and all. So paleontology, you can say, or evolutionary history of human being, that is studied in these three points, 1.1, 1.2, 1.3. Now here I want to point out, this is a point, 1.4. So many people ask, ki over syllabus kitna bada hai anthropology ka? How much big is the syllabus of anthropology? Now if you read the content of syllabus and the lines of syllabus, you will find it very bigger as compared to other many other subjects. It seems to be very big. But if you see this point, suppose theories of organic evolution, pre-Darwinian, Darwinian and post-Darwinian. Suppose if you consider this B point, they have marked, they have specified theories of organic evolution, pre-Darwinian, Darwinian and post-Darwinian. So here you can see your syllabus has been made very explicit by mentioning pre-Darwinian, Darwinian and post-Darwinian. So in pre-Darwinian theories, the most important theory is Lamarckism. So there are so many other Indological theories and theological theories which say human beings were originated from God, and there are Indological theories which say human being was originated from different organs of a God, etc. So those theories are not included in this. So organic evolution is based on these three theories, these three kinds of theories, that is pre-Darwinian, Darwinian and post-Darwinian. So by making the syllabus explicit, they have actually reduced it. Another point you can see here, 1.6 is related to human fossils or paleontology, study of fossils. Now study of fossils is again the part of evolutionary history of human being. Now you can see here the fossils have been enumerated. So Pliopleistocene hominids in South and East Africa, then Australopithecines. So this is first point. So Pliopleistocene hominids have not been asked from other continents. South and East Africa and Australopithecines have been enumerated. Then next is Homo erectus. So African Homo erectus, European Homo erectus, Asian Homo erectus, they have been enumerated. Then Neanderthal man, then La Chapelle-Ossian, Mount Carmel, then next is Rhodesian man, and last one is Homo sapiens, Cro-Magnon, Grimaldi and Chancellid. So this is a bigger description or a vast description of the paleontological part of anthropology. Now tell me, if at all I had mentioned here study of human fossils and I would have went for next topic, then which fossils you would have studied? Homo erectus has been discovered at n number of places. You have to study only these much: Paranthropus, Heidelbergensis and Javanicus and Pekinensis. These are the only four Homo erectus species or Homo erectus specimens or fossils which you have to study. There may be n number of other Homo erectus fossils, but you don't have to study them. Similarly, Neanderthal man. Neanderthal man has also been discovered at so many places. Neanderthal man is a generic name. So other fossils have been discovered at many other places. Recently, there was one Homo erectus fossil was discovered. There was a question on that Homo erectus in recent prelims. Do you remember or do you know that? So that is not asked in your anthropology syllabus. So you don't have to study those fossils, because n number of Homo erectus fossils have been included, have been discovered, but they have not been included in your syllabus. Similarly, modern man or Homo sapiens, so many modern man fossils were also discovered, but they have not been made the part of your syllabus. So by making to look it like a big point, they have actually reduced your syllabus, don't you think so? They have specified which part you have to study or which part you don't have to study. So other fossils, even if they are given in some books, you don't have to study them. You have to study only these fossils. Getting my point? So if you feel that anthropology has a bigger syllabus, it seems to be bigger because it has been explicitly detailed out. Actually, by detailing out, they have made it smaller. Getting my point? Samasthe ka mala kaya manaj. Then 1.7 is related to biological basis of life. Then cell DNA structure, replication, protein synthesis, gene, mutation, chromosomes and cell division. In last many years, at least last 3 to 4 years, you can go back to even 6 years, no question has been asked on this point, 1.7, that is biological basis of human being. This point is seen by so many students and they say that yachyamadhye tar biology ahe, and I cannot understand biology and I will not go for anthropology because I cannot understand these things. So actually question has not been asked on this, but you have to understand few basic concepts. This is of 10th class difficulty level. So you had studied all these things even in 10th class. If you could if you open the 10th class books now also, you will find more difficult terms than these terms. Aache books yachapeksha difficult. So don't worry about it, and even the questions have not been asked, but you have to understand these concepts in order to understand the next part in 9.1 to 9.8 and even 1.4 evolutionary studies. So for understanding of that, this point is important. This seems to be part of cell biology and all, but this is very easy to understand, don't worry. This is very easy to understand. Next is 1.8. This is again here the reverse happens. Here it seems to be a very small sub point of first bigger point, that is 1.8, but it is very bigger topic. So it includes almost every point of European or world archaeology. Okay, so archaeology is entirely comprised or contained in this point. So it starts from earlier studies of human beings, Paleolithic, that is Stone Age. Paleolithic, Mesolithic, Neolithic are parts of Stone Age. Then Chalcolithic is related to Bronze Age, and Copper Bronze Age is the earlier part, Chalcolithic. Then Iron Age, it is followed in second paper by, in India, Iron Age is followed by Vedic periods, post-Vedic periods, that is studied in second paper in context of India. So this is part of archaeology. So till now you have seen in point number 1, what are the points? Basics are anthropology, then paleontology, then cell biology, and this one is archaeology. So this is the biggest point of syllabus. This is the biggest point of syllabus. Then next, point number 2.1 to 2.5, 3, 4 and 5. So these points are related to sociocultural anthropology. 2.1 to 5. So in 2.1 and 2.2 you study about culture and society. What is culture? So culture, by definition, there are so many definitions of culture, like simpler definitions. Your culture is a way of life. Culture is nothing but the man-made part of environment. Then culture is construct of mind, and etc. So the definition given by Tyler defines it in a more comprehensive manner that we are not going to discuss now. But what I want to say is this culture is studied in this topic. Society in 2.2, how society is formed, what are social institutions, then what is social stratification, what is social group. So all this is studied in society, that is point number 2, nature of society. Then next is, these are very close topics, close to our hearts, marriage, family, kinship. Everyone is very interested to know about these things. Actually, everyone is part of these things, but we have to understand it in a more better manner, in a as an anthropologist. So what is marriage? What are types of marriages? Then functions of marriage. What are functions of marriage? Procreation is most important function. Development, perpetuation of our lineage or clan. So that is procreation. Second, we get psychological support from our life partner. At least females get psychological support from their partner. Well, I don't know about boys or men. Then I'm just joking. Forget about these jokes. Otherwise, someone will write in paper. Okay. Then marriage regulations. Preferential, prescriptive, proscriptive. What are marriage regulations? Then marriage payments. Bride, price and dowry. All these are studied in more scientific manner. We know these things. But we don't see them in a scientific manner. We have to do it in anthropology. Okay. We know almost everything. We know polygamy, what is polygamy? We know monogamy, what is monogamy? These are nothing but the types of marriages. Polygamy is a person is marrying with more number of persons or more than one number of persons of opposite sex. That is polygamy. Monogamy means one person is marrying with one individual of opposite sex or whatever. So that is types of marriages. You know them. But what are the reasons behind these kind of marriages? What are the implications? That we have to study in more scientific manner in this chapter. Why dowry system exists? If it is a social evil, then why does it exist? That we have to see. Why bride price is there in some tribal societies or in some simple societies, more correct to say. Why bride price concept is there and not dowry? So what are their compulsions to follow this kind of system? So all these things we have to study in this part. Marriage, family. Another thing is family. Of course, family is definitely very close to our heart. We know many things about family, but we have to again see them in more scientific manner. Okay. Kinship. Kinship is nothing but our, in most vague and simpler layman's language, kinship is nothing but study of our kins or relatives. So these relatives may be on the basis of different things. Okay. Then what are descent group? Descent is nothing but that is descent. Manje, the chain of relatives in vertical manner. Manje, grandfather, father, the ego and son, grandson. So this is a lineage. So what is lineage? It is nothing but the group of families. Then what is clan? It is nothing but the group of lineages. What is fratry? It is group of clans. What is moiety? Moiety is the half part of tribe which is formed by group of fratries. Moiety itself means half part. So all these terms related to kinship are studied in this chapter. Then economic organization. Economic organization is study of economic behavior of human beings. I told you a few minutes back how economic behavior of human being is determined. This is not determined solely on rationality. This is determined on some religious principles. This is determined on some on the basis of some political premises. So there are so many other dimensions which determine your economic behavior. Okay. So that is why this chapter focuses on the study of economics of all the societies, primitive, peasant and modern societies. So modern societies or urban societies are not paid much attention in anthropology that you study in economics. But here primitive societies are paid attention a lot. Okay, their economic system we have to understand. How pastoralists carry out their activities, how horticulturists carry out their activities. Swedening is nothing but slash and burn agriculture or shifting cultivation. How do they lead their life, economic life? So all these are studied in this chapter. Same is political anthropology. How political organizations are formed and social control is established over there. Band manje kai, tribe manje kai, chiefdom manje kai. So all these groups, political groupings, how they are formed, how they are led. So that we have to study in this chapter. Okay. Then religion. Religion is nothing but, this is not theology. religion is a study, her theology nahi hai. What do I mean by this statement? You are not going to study the principles of Hinduism, principles of Islam, principles of Christianity, Zoroastrianism. No. You are going to study the religion as an anthropologist, or how the concept of religion came. What are the functions religion carry out? What are the what are the determinants of one's religion, and how religion impacts the other spheres of life, how it affects my political life, how it affects my economic life. Getting my point? So that is nothing but religion. That is study we are going to study. So these animatism, fetishism, naturism, totemism, these words are new to me, many of you, but don't worry, these are simpler terms. Animism is nothing but belief in anima. Anima is a supernatural power. Simple language madhe atma, soul. So anima is a thing which has to do something with supernatural power. So belief in that anima is nothing but animism. Naturism is nothing but belief in nature, belief in the natural phenomenon. God, he concept tancha bhaktit lagu keli jate. So for example, trees are considered as God. Boulders or mountains are considered as gods. So that is nothing but nature chi puja. Worship of nature, that is naturism and all. Okay. Totemism, similar term. Totem is a symbol of a community and that is worshipped, or that is considered as a sacred thing. Then this part is very important. Anthropological theories. Anthropological theories are total, if we count, there are 12 to 13 theories, and we have to study anthropological theories. Always it is a part of every subject. In the same way, anthropology madhe sudha, we have to study on what premises anthropology is based, or on what premises anthropology has to be studied. Anthropology has to be taken ahead. Okay. So these are the theories. Neo-evolutionism, cultural materialism. Then culture, language and communication. I told you linguistic anthropology is one of the most important branches of anthropology. But in your syllabus, anthropology, linguistic anthropology has not been paid much attention. So there is only one single chapter dedicated to this branch. And there is some part in theories, that is in structuralism, we study some linguistic phenomena. And in chapter number 1, that is we study linguistic anthropology as a branch of anthropology. Other than that, anthropology as linguistic anthropology does not found much space in your syllabus. Okay. Then about point number 8, I told you these are research methods. It is a part of basics. Then 9.1 to 9.8 is almost genetics. Then 10 is human growth and development. 11 is demography, that is population studies. And 12 is application of anthropology, physical anthropology. Application, not all anthropology, but physical anthropology. So 9.1 to 12 number point. So this is purely physical anthropology. And this is the part. This is the part which is blamed by many, or which is considered by so many people as the most difficult part of the paper. So physical anthropology, why it is considered as difficult? Because specifically by non-biology students or non-medical students or non-science background students. So they consider this part as most difficult because it contains biology. It contains so many difficult terms. For example, if I consider this. What is ABO system, RH blood group system, HLA, HP, transferring, actually it is transferins, then blood enzymes, physiological characteristics, HB level. So these terms may seem to be very new to you guys, those who are not from biology background. Or autosomal aberrations, Down syndrome, Patau syndrome, Edwards syndrome, Kreidl-Katz syndrome, these are some diseases. You may think that these are very new to us and we may not be able to grasp these concepts and all. But believe me, I am telling you with huge responsibility, I am not at all telling you any lie. Because of this part, from 9.1 to 12, because of only this part, and point number 1.4 and 1.5 and even 1.6, because of these things in anthropology, people score maximum marks. People score maximum marks. Because this part is very straightforward and very simpler for you people. It may be difficult for medical students in their curriculum. It may be difficult for zoology students in their MSc curriculum. But for you people, this part is very easier. Difficulty level is very low. And you get full marks, almost. My full marks is not out 10 out of 10. But you get maximum marks in this part only. You get maximum marks in this part only. So you go through so many toppers lectures. They will always recommend you to go for questions on this part. So I hope you are knowing that the question paper is of 400 marks. Paper 1 is of 400 marks. Okay. Paper 1 is of 400 marks. Out of that you have to attempt 250 marks questions. Remaining 150 marks are optional. You don't have to attempt those questions. So you have to select, make wise decisions which questions you are supposed to attempt. So socio-cultural anthropology che question attempt karayche ka physical anthropology che. All the toppers will advise you, and even I will advise you to attempt the questions on this part. That is from 9.1 to 12. And even evolution, paleontology and human fossils. You will get maximum marks. You will get maximum possible marks. Because this part is in paper 1, many students will get more marks in paper 1 than paper 2. Getting my point? For those who think that biology is major part of this subject, this is a myth I am going to clarify right now. If you count the questions on physical anthropology, they are for around 50 marks. 50 to 60 marks, consider maximum 60 marks. These questions, even if I consider 80 marks, even if I consider 80 marks, then how much will be the percentage of total percentage of these questions out of total question paper? 400 marker is the paper. So how many questions are there? 80 marks. So what is the percentage? 20% of paper 1. Barabar hai? 20% of paper 1. And out of total syllabus, it forms 10%. Getting my point? So, you don't have to worry much about it. These questions can be dealt with very easily. Suppose even if you count, I told you about the compulsory questions which you have to attempt. But even if you count all the questions in physical anthropology, it will not go around or beyond 150. So if 150 mark, total physical anthropology questions in entire curriculum, in entire paper, there will be 150 mark questions. Then also it forms very less amount of your syllabus. And anthropology is projected on the basis of that part. However, this contains biology, this contains genetics, this contains medical terms and all. But believe me, this is our bad luck key. This part is very small in anthropology. Otherwise, you can score a lot. You can score a lot in this part. If at all this was 50% of the syllabus, there was a huge scope for score in this part. Okay. So even if you go for anthropology and you are supposed to attempt the questions on this part, prefer the questions on this part only. Don't prefer socio-cultural anthropology. Okay? And I am telling you with a very huge responsibility. I am not here to advise or to advertise anthropology as a subject. I am here to make you realize the mistakes which you people commit while deciding your optional. Okay? The next is race. Sorry, I told you about 12. Now this is paper 1. So paper 1.1. This is about prehistory. That is, je paper 1 madhe 1.8 madhe hota. Here, it is studied in 1.1 for Indian context. That is Indian prehistory. Indian archaeology is studied over here. In paper 2, Indian fossils are studied. That is paleontology or the fossil Ramapithecus, Sivapithecus and Narmada man. They are studied in paper 2 because they are related to Indian or paleontology. Then ethno-archaeology. What is ethno-archaeology? Study of ethnology to study archaeology. That is nothing but ethnology. I'll tell you in a very short. Suppose I have got a tool which is 2 million years ago which was existent in 2 million years or 1 million years ago. Zalak version purvicha te tools apadle. Then I want to know what kind of use they were making or what kind of thing they were doing with this kind of tool. So now what you can do, you can find the similar kind of tool in some tribal communities which they are using today. So if they are using that tool for cutting of trees, you can assume or presume that the tool which we have got from older times must have been used for similar purposes. Samajhte mala kya mhanayche? So the tool must, the similar tool must have been, is being used for this purpose. So this tool must have been used for similar kind of purpose in older times. So this is nothing but you are studying present culture to apply its principles to study of old culture. You are studying ethnology to apply its principles to archaeology. Getting my point? And that's why this is, that is called as ethno-archaeology. That's why it is called as ethno-archaeology. Then demographic profile of India. So what kind of society or what kind of social groups are present in India? Religions in India and all. Languages in India. All these are studied in this chapter. Then structure and nature of traditional Indian system. So Varnashram, Purusharatha, Karma, Rina, Rebirth. So these are integral parts of Indian social system. They affect our social life. Do they affect our social life? Definitely. So what are Varnashram? Varnashrama consists of, or it comprises of 4 Varnas. You have a Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. Then Purusharthas? Yes, Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha. So these are the 4 Purusharthas for which human beings should strive, or that has been given in our older scriptures or older literature. So this Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha, or these Purusharatha determine our social behavior. They determine our social behavior. Okay. They determine our culture. That's why we have to study them. Karma. This karma theory affects our behavior. That affects our society. That affects our culture. That's why we have to study these things. Rina and Rebirtha. Rina manje matra, sorry, Pitru Rin. The Atithirin and all. So that we have to study, because these also affect our culture. That's why we have to study them. Then caste system in India. Caste system in India, this is going to the caste system is of course the part of Indian social system. It is an integral part of Indian society, and that we have to study it. Okay. So what is Varna and what is caste? What is theory, what are theories of origins of caste? Why castes, different castes emerged? Then dominant caste, caste mobility, future of caste system. Is caste system going to remain? Or it is going to get vanished in few years or few decades or few centuries? So what are different opinions about it? That we have to study. We have to make our own opinions also. Jajmani system, tribe and caste continuum. So these are some concepts. Jajmani system is nothing but Balute Dare system, Vyavastha Maithiya. So in village systems, this is operative. There is one Jajman and there are some service providers. There is one Jajman and there are some service providers. And they are interdependent on each other. So that is Jajmani system, which works in villages. Sacred complex and nature man spirit complex. So these are 2 terms developed by LP Vidyarthi. These are a bit technical, you have to understand, you have to read. I am not going to explain it right now. But these are easier. These are easier, don't worry. Impact of Buddhism, Jainism, Islam and Christianity on Indian society. Because these are new religions to India. The oldest religion is considered as Hinduism. That was the base. So that's why how it has modified, how these religions have modified the Indian society. That we have to study here. Okay. So in every aspect, every religion has affected or has changed our nature. For example, just for example, our cuisine or our food habits, they have been modified by different religions. For example, aplyamadhe Islam ne anlele baryas goshti ahet je apan aaj khato pito, किंवा वेस्टर्न सोसायटीजनी ख्रिश्चनांनी आणलेल्या बऱ्याच गोष्टी आहेत की ज्या आपण आज खातो पितो. सो अवर ड्रेस पॅटर्न, अवर फूड, नॉट इवन ड्रेस अँड फूड, मेनी अदर पॉलिटिकल नेचर ऑर द इकॉनॉमिक, सो मेनी लाईफ, सो मेनी फॅसेट्स ऑफ लाईफ हॅव बीन चेंज्ड बाय डिफरंट रिलीजन्स अँड हाऊ दे हॅव अफेक्टेड अवर लाईफ, हाऊ दे हॅव अफेक्टेड अवर कल्चर, दॅट इज स्टडीड इन दिस पॉईंट. ओके, देन हाऊ अँथ्रोपॉलॉजी डेव्हलप्ड इन इंडिया. I told you anthropology is a very new branch. Anthropology is a very new branch and in neonatal stage. So how in India it has developed? Who are the leading anthropologists of India? So that is part of this point. M.N. Srinivas, L.P. Vidyarthi, Sankalia. So there are so many anthropologists which are studied in this part. Then Indian village studies. What are villages? You know. So villages are very important from study of Indian society, point of Indian study of Indian society. Why? Because villages form the India in microcosm. So if you want to study the characteristics of India, you have to study village. Jasa apan mhanto na, if you want to study the properties of element, you can study one atom and you can tell the properties of total element. So in the same way, if you study the village, you can study, you can give the characteristics of India. Because every village you will find almost people from every caste, almost every caste. So that's why the caste system is said to be operative at village level. Getting my point? So that's why if you study the village, you will get the idea of India. That's why villages are studied. Then 5.2, linguistic and religious minorities and their socio-political economic status in India. What are linguistic minorities? What are religious minorities? How many religious minorities are there in India? All are studied. Islam, Christianity, Sikhism, Zoroastrianism, Jainism, Buddhism, all are studied in this part. Then indigenous and exogenous processes of socio-cultural change. So you have to understand what is socio-cultural change. Nothing but change in culture. How it is brought about. How socio-cultural change is brought about. So there are various processes. So suppose, just for example, I will explain what is Sanskritization. Sanskritization is nothing but practice of imitating or mimicking the practices of higher castes or higher varnas. So if I am from lower caste, I will mimic or mime the practices of higher varnas. So that is Sanskritization. What is the motive? What is the intention? To achieve that higher status. Because they have that higher status because of those practices. Getting my point? So I will also adopt those practices so that I will be uplifted. That is the belief. So in that belief, people try to imitate the practices of higher castes or higher varnas. So that is Sanskritization. Westernization is nothing but the adoption of Western practices, not practices of higher varnas, but Western practices. So these are the processes by which the culture keeps on changing. So socio-cultural change is brought about by these processes. Then interplay of little traditions and great traditions. So these are also somewhat technical terms. Once you start to study, you will get them. Little traditions and great traditions. Little traditions are operative at local level. Great traditions are operative at pan India or at universal level. So suppose if you consider a god like Ganesha, Sri Ganesha. So this god is considered as a god in every nooks and corners of India. But if you consider a god, like a name of god like Yellamma Devi, you must have heard in rural areas. So these kind of gods are worshipped by only local communities. These are parts of little tradition. Getting my point? These are parts of little tradition, while Ganesha is part of great tradition because it has universal acceptance. It has acceptance by all, acceptance by masses. Getting my point? But little traditions have acceptance by only local folks. So that is studied over here. Then media and social change. What is media and what is social change? That is how social change is brought about by media. Media includes every kind of media. not only audio-visual media, or not only social media, or not only print media. Media is media. So how it brings about social change, that is studied over here. Then tribal situation, biogenetic variability. That is, biogenetic variability is nothing but the racial elements in Indian tribes. What kind of racial elements are present in Indian tribes. So this part is related to tribal anthropology, 6.1, 6.2, even 6.3. Then 7.1 is related to scheduled castes, scheduled tribes. Not scheduled tribes much. Scheduled tribes tumhi agodar shikta. But what is scheduled tribes? What are the political provisions or legal provisions related to them? What are OBCs? What are constitutional safeguards and legal safeguards, etc.? That is studied in this part. 7.2, social change and contemporary tribal societies. What is the impact of social change on tribal societies? That is studied in this part of syllabus. Then what is concept of ethnicity? Ethnicity is nothing but, what is, first of all, what is ethnic, what does ethnic denote? It is related to a kind of cultural identity. Ethnic identity is nothing but the kind of cultural identity that we get on the basis of any ethnic element. May it be language, caste, creed, race, religion, nation. So all these are ethnic identities. We get the identity as an Indian. So that is our ethnic identity. We get the identity as a Hindu or Muslim or Christian. That is our ethnic identity. Okay. So on the basis of that, this ethnicity is developed. Then regionalism, demand for autonomy, pseudo-tribalism. So these are some terms related to these tribal issues. Social change among the tribes during colonial and post-independent India. So how tribals have changed their status right from the time of pre-independence to today's era. So that is studied in this part. Then impact of Hinduism, Buddhism, Christianity, Islam on these tribal societies. So 95% of the Indian tribes have converted themselves, or they are following Hindu ways of life. So it is their impact. It is the impact on those tribes. So tribes and the mainstream religions are different. Tribes are following, tribes were following their traditional religions like animism, naturism, animatism. Getting my point? So they were not worshipping these Hindu gods, but with the time, these are being influenced, or these have been affected, these have been influenced by mainstream religions. So what are those influences that we have to study here? Tribe and nation state. So what is nation state? Actually, it will require a bit of time to explain what is nation state. State is something different. State is a geographical entity. Nation is something different. That is a psychological entity. That is a psychological concept. So, we have developed as a state, but we are not fully developed as a nation. We are a nation in building. So, what is that nation? So, when you integrate each and every individual in the frame of Indian, then it is nation building. And that nation building is still going on. Many people say that we have built as a nation, we have developed as a nation, but still, we have to accept one thing, that India is still a nation in building. We have not included so many elements of our society, Indian society, into the frame of nation. So that is, that process is nothing but nation building. And when the state and the nation exactly overlap each other, then it is called as nation state. Getting my point? So what is nation state, what is tribe, that we will study in this part. There are some additional points also. Then, history of administration of tribal areas. How tribal areas were administered during pre-independent era, how they are administered today, what are the powers of governor, what are the powers of president. This is related to a bit of polity part, related to tribal areas and all. What is concept of PTG, or now it is called as PVTG. Earlier it was called as primitive tribal groups. Now it is called as particularly vulnerable tribal groups. So what are those PVTGs, special programs for their development, roles of NGOs in tribal development. So what is the importance of NGOs? Because government is not much efficient. NGOs are more efficient in bringing out change in the life of tribals. So that is studied in this part. What is the importance of NGOs and why is it so? Why tribals believe in NGOs than government or any other mechanism? So role of anthropology in tribal and rural development? Is there any role anthropology can play? I'll just tell you one example. I told you, human behavior is not an isolated step. It is always intertwined with other spheres of life as well. Now suppose there was one incidence in Maharashtra itself. There was a scheme of government Nirmal Bharat Yojana, under which the toilets were being built across the villages, and they were the subsidy was given to the rural people, rural area, tribal people also. And there was once there was inspection. When the inspection team reached one village in Melghat in Amravati district, they noticed in one village that these toilets are not being used properly. So some people have been using them as a storehouse. So they were not using the toilet as a toilet, but a storehouse, because that was the only building they had which was made from concrete and which was a protective thing. Concrete person manli, so rain could not enter it, water could not enter it, so the food grains could be stored very easily over there. So many people were using for different purposes, no one was using for the purpose for which it was made. So basically poverty was the basic reason, and their priorities were different. This part we can ignore. There was one individual, his name was Hamid. There was one individual, and he was from a well-to-do family. He was having a good home where he could store his food grains, or there was no any problem to him. He was earning a smart livelihood. He was not rich, but he was fine with his life. But he was also not using the toilet. The toilet was as it is the day from which it was built. And this inspection team asked him, why you are not using it? We can understand about others. Why you are not using it? So he said, actually, the toilet is facing towards west. And in our religion, the west direction is very sacred, and I cannot sit for toilet by facing towards west. Now, here comes the role of anthropologist. If your developmental program or implementation of your developmental program is not considering these kind of religious beliefs of human beings, which are integral part of their life, then your developmental programs are liable to fail. Getting my point? So if you ignore these kind of things, and if you do not seek the opinion of anthropologists, then you are liable to fail. Another example is again related to Islam, Islamic banking. So religious belief is that to give loan and to take loan is sinful activity in Islam. So that's why banking was considered as un-Islamic. So some modifications were made in these banking operations, and it was promoted as Islamic banking. It is again nothing but giving respect to their religious belief and carrying out our banking operations which are beneficial to them. So if you apply the similar banking operations, if you implement the similar banking operations where these kind of beliefs are very rigid, then your banking operations or your banking initiatives are going to fail. Getting my point? So anthropology assists in that manner, because anthropology studies your integrated behavior, how the system, one aspect of your change in one aspect of your life is going to affect the other spheres of your life. Eka goshticha parinam bakicha goshtinvar patti pan hoto, how it affects the other spheres of life, that is studied by anthropologists, and their inputs are very important. Okay, so these are many things which are very interesting to learn. Okay, then contribution of anthropology to the understanding of regionalism, communalism, ethnic and political movements. So regionalism cannot be termed as just seeking autonomy for their own region. There are many underpinnings, many basic reasons for that. Communalism, it has to do with lot of other things. So it is not always the Hindu-Muslim struggle. Communal struggle is not always a Hindu-Muslim struggle. Specifically, it is not always a religious struggle. It is also many times a power struggle. It is also many times the struggle for control over economic resources. It is always or many times a struggle between haves and have-nots. So you cannot paint it with only religious conflict. Okay. So all these things, all the other factors which are involved in these ethnic movements, political movements, communalism, regionalism, we have to study in this part. So this is our entire syllabus. Rough idea. You may not get the complete idea of syllabus, but this is a rough idea of syllabus. This is a rough idea of syllabus. Now, we have to consider in exam-oriented manner. This subject seems to be very interesting, but does it help in exam actually? So we have to consider these things. First is, do we have to mug up the things? Do we have to mug up the things? Yes, definitely you have to mug up the things. And everywhere you have to mug up the things. I will not say ki ha patantaracha subject nahi hai. This is not about mugging up. Asa, I will not say. Why? Because there are so many things which you have to mug up. But it is not like each and every subject, each and every chapter is having so much data that you have to mug up. It is not like that. There are few things. For example, you have to remember the names of tribal societies in different regions of India. That you have to mug up. There is no any alternative. Once or twice, if you try to remember them, you will be able to remember. Then another suppose there is chromosomal abnormalities. So, trisomy 21 is the name for Down syndrome. Then what is the name for trisomy 18? Then what is the name for trisomy 13? So, what is Klinefelter syndrome? That you have to remember. That you have to make it by heart. So, these things you have to mug up. Definitely. Few things you have to mug up. Conceptual understanding. Does it require conceptual understanding? Of course. Every subject requires it. So, there are many concepts. And basically, why it is interesting? Because concepts are very attractive. That is, you will love to learn them. You will love to learn them. I suppose how non-verbal communication plays a role in our life. As a question, how non-verbal communication plays a role in our life. So what is non-verbal communication? Actions. Is it only actions? Expressions. So this is not the communication with actions, expression, this is not to be defined in that way. You have to define it in a way like, it is communication without words, written or spoken. It is communication without words. Shabda vachana tula kalaveji apan manto. That is non-verbal communication. So how does it affect our life? Or how does it affect our behavior? So non-verbal communication can be used at many instances. For example, if I talk to you in this manner, you will get it directly. You will get it directly what I want to say. It also indicates our attitude. If I am looking at you like this, or if I am giving a smile, that indicates our mood or our nature. So study of these things are very interesting in language. Non-verbal communication asel, kiwa the concepts in culture asel, concepts in theories. All these things are very, very funny to understand, very funny. The concepts are very interesting to study. So that's why this part should not bother you. Does it need conceptual understanding? Of course, it needs. Concepts are easier to understand and very interesting because these are the concepts which are present around us. You will see the caste system around you. But you will not look at it as an anthropologist will look. You will see the dowry system around you, but you will not look at it as something different. Suppose, for example, bride price and dowry. These are the marriage payments. It has become a social evil. Dowry has become a social evil. But to anthropologist's eye, it has some functional role in society. It may not be operative in our society, but in some tribal societies, it acts as the channel of redistribution of wealth. In our society, redistribution of wealth is being happened through taxation and social schemes and all. In simple societies, it is dowry which is responsible for channelizing the wealth from one point to another point, or bride price. It has become evil in our modern society. Many tribal societies are very happy with it. They don't have any problem. Many tribal societies, not every tribal society. So we have to look at all these aspects. We have to look at these things through all the angles. Okay? So concepts are easier. Diagrams, flowcharts, tables, do we need them to draw in the paper? Yes. But not to the extent of geography. Or not to the extent of diagram based subjects like geometry and all. I don't know which subjects need it in exhaustive manner. But anthropology, there are no clear cut areas ki the diagram in this question is compulsory. Except some fossils, there are no criteria. If you don't draw a diagram, you will not get marks. There is no any such criteria. Except some few questions, two or three questions. But if you draw the flowcharts and diagrams, it will add value to your answers, it will save your life. And there is very huge scope to draw diagrams. In history, you may not be able to draw diagrams in every question. Here, there is scope. There is opportunity to draw diagrams and save your time. Getting my point? You can draw flowcharts, you can draw tables, write down the few things in tables. So, there are ways to save your time. Okay. So this is about what kind of subject it is. The next is study material. It is very difficult to discuss the study material right now because it is necessary to study every point from different source, because no any single source is actually, this line was not written for you. It was for earlier seminar at some other place. So actually I had made a note indicating which point of the syllabus has to be read from which part. So probably in next few days I will be making that note available to you people also. So I have, in that note I have made distinction. First 3 points are to be read from Reddy's notes. Second four points are to be read from Karthik's notes. Last point is to be read from again Reddy's notes. Second to fifth are read from Karthik's notes. So in that manner I have segregated the points and I have given the study material. Study material you can get anytime. You can get from many people. In addition, these are few online sources. Better India, then website of Ministry of Tribal Affairs, then Social Story, there is another website. E-Paathshala YouTube channel and website of University of Alabama. So these are some online sources from where you have to collect your notes, you have to collect your value addition material. So I will give it in detail through some hard copy. It will be distributed to you, don't worry. This thing you have to remember, don't read the books like, I have not written it over here, but I will tell you orally. So suppose there is a mention of a book, Chrysanthemum and Sword. In this book, Margaret Mead or Ruth Benedict or any other anthropologist has made this reference, or Village India or Indian Villages. These are the books written by the famous anthropologists. You don't have to read those books. Getting my point? You don't have to go to those books, that kind of literature. That is not useful to you, not required to you. That is not necessary and not even sufficient condition. Getting my point, which kind of books you have to avoid? These basic literature asta na, suppose a book has been written by some anthropologist by studying some Australian tribals, Australian societies, or some Oceania island was explored by him and he has described the life of those people in that book. You don't have to read these kind of books. Because we may get attracted to those names of those books. E.B. Tyler has described or defined amuk amuk concept in amuk amuk book. So we will read that book. No, you don't need to read those books. Even you don't need to read whole IGNU notes. IGNU notes are to be referred at some points only. Okay. You don't have to read entire IGNU material. MSI IGNU material. Then third, you don't have to read entire Ember and Ember book. Ember and Ember is a book on general anthropology. You can get an idea about what is anthropology, but you don't have to read it entirely. You can get some few things after reading the entire syllabus, after completing your syllabus, for value addition, for some examples, for some diagrams, for some tables, for flow charts. You can refer to Ember and Ember, but you don't have to read it in entirety. Getting my point? Because that is always a bit difficult to understand. The languages of foreign authors, so their English is of different level. At least I could not understand. So it is very difficult to understand and not even necessary. You can read, for general anthropology, you can need Nadeem Asnan's book, General Anthropology by Nadeem Asnan. Then Shukla Rastogi has written a book on physical anthropology that you don't have to read. So many people have mentioned, I personally tell not to read that book, but because that is not much useful. For physical anthropology, you can read P. Nath's book or even B.M. Das, but not Shukla Rastogi. Or any other bigger resources are not to be followed by you people. Any other bigger resources are not to be followed by you people. Now, you may find some study material in my notes. I will give you a note. These are the books you have to follow. Some other topper may give you his own book list. Another topper will give you his own book list or her own book list. Then you may get confused. What to do then? Then I advise you to follow any one of the individuals religiously. Getting my point? Because all these people are giving you different routes which are reaching at the same destination, because they have reached over there. These are like religions. Har dharm ek hi baat kehta hai. Ant mein ek hi baat kehta hai. Usi prakar se all these resources told by different individuals will lead you to the same destination. So don't worry. Just don't mix up. Or don't try to overlap those all the resources and make a big list. Read less, revise more. Refer to any kind of book list by any one individual in whom you have belief, in whom you have faith. Not necessarily me, or not necessarily Akshat Jain, or not necessarily any other topper. Anyone you think that this person is honest, or this person is telling very honestly, I should follow this book list and this is somewhat realistic also, then I will follow that. So think in that way. Okay? Don't make a big book list at all, because you will defeat the purpose then. Anthropology is a very small subject actually. In my personal view, 1500 pages will be more than enough for entire syllabus, for getting mastery over it. 1500 pages. But if you compile huge stack of books, then it will defeat the purpose of subject. Chota asun mag tumhi tasa kay fayda karun ghetla. Getting my point? Second, study material should be preferably in Indian language. That is Indian author. So, like Ember and Ember, if at all there is any foreign language book, you please avoid it, because it will be in a very difficult tone and you may not be able to grasp it as easier as an Indian resource. Okay. Then, most important question. Who should or who can take anthropology? Anyone from these people? Anyone from these people? Now, let me be very frank to you people. I have been through your phase. And I am supposed to be very responsible to give you very authentic advice. This is not for marketing anthropology as the best optional. This is not for convincing you people to take anthropology. This is just to make you aware of what is anthropology. Decision has to be taken by only you people. Never ask this question, ki, should I take anthropology? No. That has to be decided by you people. What you should ask, what are the glitches in anthropology according to you? What are the stronger areas where we can score marks in anthropology? What are the attributes a candidate needs if he wants to opt for anthropology? Is it suitable for me? Or shall I think of anthropology? So you can ask these kind of questions, but you should not ask, shall I take anthropology? That's a direct question. Don't ask to anyone except self. But I have said, everyone can take anthropology. Everyone can take anthropology. So obviously the question will be next one. First question. Is syllabus very vast? I say no. As compared to geography, history, political science, and even public administration, syllabus is very small. Very, 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 very small. Sociology, anthropology, psychology, these syllabi are very small. Anthropology is definitely very small. There are so many students. There were so many students in my batch, including Hemanta Patil of this year, rank 39. He had studied his earlier optional for 2 to 3 years somewhere. Then he left and he came to anthropology batch, and he started even after prelims, and he secured IRS in his first attempt with anthropology. He could cover, and he said, this is his opinion, I'm not, you can ask him personally also. He said ki he could complete anthropology even in less than half of the time which he had given to geography earlier. This is not the story of everyone. Some may find more interest in geography also. It is not like everyone will find interest in anthropology only and everyone will have geography as their most difficult area. No. Some people may definitely find more interest in geography. They should go for geography only. But if you compare the content, definitely geography, anthropology is a smaller subject. Anthropology is a smaller subject. This is his opinion, not only mine. I am just conveying it to you. Second thing, what if I had not taken biology in my 12th class? Now take it. Because 12th class ke biology se bhi easier part hai. Getting my point? So, you will find more difficult terms in today's ICSC books of 10th class than these concepts. Even in 12th class, you will find hell of difficult terms than this part. So if you could understand 10th class science, then you can understand this kind of biology. This is very easier. And actually, you are not supposed to give biology exam over here. You are supposed to give anthropology exam. And anthropology is not a branch of science as a faculty, as a fraternity, as a discipline. It is not a branch of science. It is a branch of arts. You get MA degree in anthropology, not MSc. So the proficiency which is required from anthropology students is not similar to the proficiency which is required from zoology students or botany students. Getting my point? So difficulty level is much less. So don't worry about if you had not taken biology. Okay? So don't worry about that part. Actually, I guarantee you that you will score maximum marks in the questions of biology and physical anthropology only. If you at all go for anthropology and you write the paper, you will find while writing the paper that you got good marks in paper 1 just because of physical anthropology. And this is not only my opinion. You hear to any topper's speech, they will tell you the same. Okay. I am a medical graduate, will it benefit me? Or I am not a medical graduate, will it harm me? Is it again a common question? It is again a common question. How many are medicos over here? MBBS? BAMS, BDS, no one. You are a medical graduate, okay. So, these people are benefited, I will tell you to what extent. Suppose, these are the terms. Klinefelter syndrome, Turner syndrome, or Down syndrome, other syndromic disorders. Medicos will be benefited to this extent only, these terms will not be new to them. But the answers they are writing for these terms in their medical curriculum are totally different from the answers which they have to write in anthropology curriculum. Just for example, I'll tell you. There was one incidence told by Srinivas sir in Delhi to our batch at that time. There was a question, respiratory functions. Short note. Respiratory functions. That's all. You have to write a 10 marker question. And what happened? Few guys from zoology background wrote about respiratory system. So it involves airway, trachea, bronchi, lungs, alveoli, air. So all these things, and they wrote about it, respiratory system. Doctors or MBBS students wrote about respiratory function tests, or these are also called as pulmonary function tests. So you must be knowing about forced expiratory volume or inspiratory volume or tidal volume. How much air can be inhaled? So suppose it is beyond some limit, your lungs are okay. If it is below some limit, your lungs are not okay. So these are respiratory pulmonary function tests. So he wrote about respiratory function in that manner. One botany student was there, he wrote about electron transport chain, glycolysis, Krebs cycle. So you must be knowing these terms. Jana biology baravila hota. So how respiration occurs. So they wrote about it. And many engineering students, they were knowing what exactly is expected over here. So how respiratory system is affected across different geographical regions and across different races, and how do they vary? So that was the main component of the question answer. So that you will study when you will study anthropology. But that was the actual answer, and no one who had a biology background had interpreted that question correctly. So sometimes it is harmful to be a medico and biology background student if such kind of question comes. Okay. Another thing, suppose there is a question on protein synthesis at all, if at all it is asked. Protein synthesis, a medico will always go for biochemistry Satyanarayan book, open Karel's first years, and he will try to read from that book. And their protein synthesis has been given on, I think, 7 to 8 pages. Not necessary at all. You have to prepare only 1 page note for lifetime. So engineers do it very nicely many times. Because they know this much is the 150 word matter that I have to copy and paste in the answer. Nothing else is required. Actually, that is necessary. And that's why you will find anthropologists scores have been very excellent among engineers, because biology knowledge is not at all a necessity nor a sufficient condition. I was supposed to tell this one also. Klinefelter syndrome or Down syndrome. Let us consider Down syndrome. If I am supposed to write a question on Down syndrome, I am a medico, then what is in my curriculum of MBBS about Down syndrome? Down syndrome baddal kay ahe? Suppose Down syndrome I have to study for MBBS, then I will have to study its symptoms, its signs, its diagnostic tests, the findings of diagnostic tests, skull cha x-ray kay dakhvel, kiwa itar bone che x-ray kay dakhvatil, chest x-ray kay dakhvel, what are the laboratory findings, complete blood count kela tar tyachat kay findings yetil, what are the other findings of the other some pathological tests or all. What is the requirement of blood for particular aged group, child, or what are the implications or what are the side effects of that treatment if the blood is recurrently replaced? What is siderosis or hemosiderosis and all? So these are the answers one has to prepare in medical curriculum. In anthropology, you are supposed to know why Down syndrome occurs. So Down syndrome is more common in the children of mothers who give their birth to children after 32 years of age. So it is more common in those girls. So what is the cultural basis for these late marriages? So the societies where these late marriages are common, you will find the frequency of Down syndrome in more number. So what are the cultural reasons or cultural causes of these kind of disorders? That you have to focus on in anthropology. major focus is on that. You, of course, you have to study the symptoms, but symptoms as a part of the study of this disease is very less in your anthropology. You have to focus on other aspects of that disease. Another example, thalassemia or sickle cell anemia or other diseases. Thalassemia is the most common term in pediatric wards. Thalassemia has different wards for that purpose. Why thalassemia occurs? Or what is the basic reason of occurrence of thalassemia? The hemoglobin che char chains astat, the chains bigadlele astat. So hemoglobin chains are malformed or not formed. So hemoglobin and in turn RBCs are not working properly. So hemolysis is there and all the other complications occur. So again, what are the symptoms, what are the treatment modules, what are the side effects of those treatments, what are the number of cycles through which we have to change the blood periodically and all, that we have to study. But sorry, Down syndrome does not require blood transfusions. This requires blood transfusion. So here blood transfusion was wrongly uttered by me in that discussion, but here it is required. Thalassemia requires blood transfusion, recurrent blood transfusions. So that we have to study here. But what is the cultural basis of that disease, or what is the cultural aspect or socio-cultural reason for that disease? That is the main emphasis of anthropology. So thalassemia is common among those societies where the marriages between close blood relatives are common. So there is always first question asked by a doctor to a parent of thalassemia child, thalassemia patient. तुमचं लग्न नात्यात झालंय का? हॅव यू मॅरिड इन युअर ओन अमॉंग्स विथ अन इंडिव्हिज्युअल अमॉंग्स युअर ओन रिलेटिव्ज? सो देर आर मॅटर्नल क्रॉस कझिन मॅरेजेस, की बाबा मामा की लडकी के साथ विवाह हुआ है, या जो क्या आत्याला इंग्रजीत काय म्हणता तुम्ही, बुआजी की लडकी के साथ विवाह हुआ है, सो वट एव्हर. सो इफ एट ऑल दोज काइंड ऑफ मॅरेजेस आर कॉमन इन अ सोसायटी, you will find incidence of thalassemia to a great extent. So this is socio-cultural basis of that disease. You have to focus on that. You have to focus on that in anthropology. So what medicos or biology students will get benefit, they will be known with these terms. They will be familiar with these terms. But they have to prepare the answers like other guys also. Other guys only. They are not well acquainted with the knowledge of anthropology regarding these topics. Getting my point? So they have to prepare afresh. They have to prepare from scratch, almost from scratch. They just know the names. They have to prepare other things for anthropology in an entirely new manner. Okay? Then next question is usually asked, sociology or anthropology, because there is so much overlapping. There is usually a very rare question, whereby should I go for geography or anthropology? So this is not usually asked, because those who want to go for geography, they are very clear that they don't want to go for anthropology. Or those who are supposed to go for anthropology, they are very clear they don't want to go for geography. Similarly, political science and geography, there is never a conflict. Or history and anthropology, there is never a conflict. People know very clearly whether I want to go for history or anthropology. They are very clear. These are two subjects where maximum conflict occurs, maximum dilemma occurs. Should I go for anthropology or should I go for sociology? Why? Because there is so much overlapping of syllabus. Sociology has those topics, marriage, family, kinship. Sociology has study of tribes. Sociology has many topics from anthropology. So there is a dilemma. You could have subject you. So here my one sentence answer is, if you are interested in writing straightforward answers, go for anthropology. And if you are interested in designing the answers or generating the answers by applying your own mind, then sociology is a better choice for you people. So everyone has his own strong area. Straightforward answers, Down syndrome, symptoms, frequency, cultural factors, any genetic mechanism, दॅट्स इट. म्हणजे हे चार पाच पॉईंट झाले, हेच पॉईंट्स तुम्हाला लिहायचे आहेत, ह्याच्यावरच तुम्हाला प्रश्न पडणार आहेत. व्हॉट इज द इम्पॅक्ट ऑफ फेमिनिस्ट मुवमेंट्स ऑन रुरल फिमेल बिटवीन एज ग्रुप ऑफ अमुक अमुक. सो इफ यू आर सपोज टू थिंक ऑन दिस क्वेश्चन अँड यू फाइंड इट इंटरेस्टिंग टू जनरेट द आन्सर्स अँड अप्लाय युअर ओन माइंड, देन सोशियोलॉजी इज अ बेटर ऑप्शन फॉर यू. स्ट्रेट फॉर आय एम नॉट सेईंग युअर अनालिटिकल क्वेश्चन्स आर नॉट देअर इन अँथ्रोपोलॉजी, आय एम नॉट सेईंग दॅट, बट द नंबर ऑफ क्वेश्चन्स, नंबर ऑफ अनालिटिकल क्वेश्चन्स आर डेफिनेटली लो ऑर लेस इन अँथ्रोपोलॉजी. मॅक्सिमम क्वेश्चन्स आर स्ट्रेट फॉरवर्ड, मॅक्सिमम क्वेश्चन्स आर स्ट्रेट फॉरवर्ड. ओके, हाऊ मच टाइम इज रिक्वायर्ड टू कम्प्लीट द सिलेबस? लेस दॅन हिस्ट्री, पॉलिटिकल सायन्स, ज्योग्राफी, प बॅड. सिमिलर टू सोशियोलॉजी, सायकोलॉजी, फिलॉसॉफी, समजते? सो त्या लाईन्सवरती दिस इज जनरल आन्सर. इट ऑलवेज डिपेंड्स ऑन युअर ओन ॲप्टिट्यूड, युअर ओन इंटरेस्ट, युअर ओन कपॅसिटी, युअर ओन वे ऑफ स्टडिंग. इफ यू आर स्टडिंग डेली फॉर ओनली 2 hours ओनली, यू कॅनॉट फिनिश इट विद इन 3 months. इफ यू आर एन्टायरली स्पेंडिंग युअर टाइम इन अँथ्रोपोलॉजी ऑर ऑप्शनल ओनली, यू कॅन फिनिश इट विद इन 2 months ऑल्सो. अदरवाइज दररोज फक्त 2 तास करतोय, यू मे रिक्वायर 7 or 8 months ऑल्सो. सो इट डिपेंड्स इंडिव्हिज्युअली, बट स्टील इफ यू स्पेंड इक्वल टाइम, इट युजली नीड्स, युजली म्हणण्यापेक्षा इट 99% नीड्स लेस टाइम दॅन द सब्जेक्ट्स लाईक ज्योग्राफी, हिस्ट्री अँड पॉलिटिकल सायन्स, अँड ऑलमोस्ट इक्विवॅलंट टाइम टू दॅट ऑफ सायकोलॉजी, फिलॉसॉफी, सोशियोलॉजी एटसेट्रा. सो सायकोलॉजी, फिलॉसॉफी, सोशियोलॉजी, अँथ्रोपोलॉजी, दीज आर कन्सिडर्ड एज स्मॉलर सब्जेक्ट्स. देन विच मीडियम शुड आय प्रेफर? इंग्लिश, इंग्लिश, इंग्लिश. इफ यू आर ऑप्टिंग फॉर अँथ्रोपोलॉजी, इन माय ओपिनियन डोंट गो फॉर मराठी मीडियम. जेनेटिक्स इज सच अ हॅवॉक इन मराठी. आय कॅनॉट थिंक ऑफ रायटिंग आन्सर्स इन मराठी. इफ यू आर हॅव्हिंग जाज्वल्य अभिमान ऑफ मराठी, देन गो फॉर इट, अदरवाइज डोंट गो फॉर इट. इफ यू थिंक दॅट यू विल फाइंड अँथ्रोपोलॉजी इझी इन मराठी, देन इट इज रॉंग. इट इज युअर मिसअंडरस्टँडिंग. सेकंड फॅक्टर इज यू डोंट हॅव स्टडी मटेरियल अवेलेबल इन मराठी. यू हॅव सम बुक्स इन मराठी विच आर रिटन ऑन अँथ्रोपोलॉजी, बट वो जुगाड है, दो दॅट बुक लिस्ट इज अ जुगाड, दॅट इज नॉट अ परफेक्ट स्टडी मटेरियल एज यू आर हॅविंग इन इंग्लिश. ओके, यू डोंट हॅव एनी गायडन्स इन मराठी. इफ एट ऑल इट इज अवेलेबल, इफ द स्टडी मटेरियल इज अवेलेबल टू यू अँड इफ यू हॅव जाज्वल्य अभिमान ऑफ मराठी, देन यू गो फॉर मराठी एज अ मीडियम फॉर अँथ्रोपोलॉजी. अदरवाइज राईट इट इन इंग्लिश, इट इज व्हेरी इझियर. ट्रेंड ऑफ स्कोर्स अँड स्केलिंग डाऊन ऑफ सब्जेक्ट्स. आय एम नॉट इंटरेस्टेड इन एक्सप्लेनिंग दीज डाऊट्स ऍक्च्युली, बट दीज आर फ्रिक्वेंट क्वेश्चन्स अँड दॅट्स वाय आय हॅव टू. ट्रेंड ऑफ स्कोर्स अँड स्केलिंग डाऊन ऑफ द सब्जेक्ट. ऍक्च्युली विल अँथ्रोपोलॉजी परफॉर्म बेटर नेक्स्ट इयर ऑर विल देर बी एनी स्केलिंग डाऊन? वी डोंट नो. नो वन नोज दिस. एनी वन can't tell which subject will be scaled down next year or whether there will be any subject which will be scaled down. We don't know. Simply we don't know. Will there be any scaling down? And how is the nature of scores? Doesn't matter. Or we can't predict at all kya anthropology che scores yetil ka. Again, even if I have told you, or even if I have answered you in the favor of anthropology, here also I will tell you for the sake of your understanding or for the sake of your convenience. So many of you may be having this question in your mind, trend of scores and scaling down. Till date, anthropology has not been scaled down, and till date, since last 6 years, anthropology people have scored excellent marks in their papers. If at all they have studied nicely, they have scored very nice marks. They have scored very nice marks. Ha, main anthropology ghetla hai, pan abhyasas nahi kelela, that is different story. If you have not studied, you will not get marks. But those who have studied smartly, sufficiently, they have got good marks. No one has been scaled down till date. No one has been scaled down till date. I can't guarantee for next year. I can't guarantee that. No one can guarantee. But this subject will not be scaled down in next year. No. I think that anthropology will not be scaled down because of few reasons. Because anthropology is not considered as generic subject by students. Like history, geography, political science, these are considered as generic subjects. Anyone can take geography. Even doctors you will find, arts graduates, commerce graduates, everyone you will find, they are taking geography. Anthropology is feared by, unnecessarily feared by students. So it has biology, it has medical terms. I am not having biology. I was not having biology in my 12th class. So this is undue fear in minds of so many people. That's why anthropology is not opted by many students. It is not opted by many students. You will say, ki baba kiti tari loka ghyayla laglet. Delhi madhe kiti loka ghetayet. Itha azubazula bagalto anthropology. So many people are taking. Your figures are from very limited sample size. Anthropology, if you compare the students appearing for mains, in the students of geography, history, political science, these are almost 3 to 4 times than anthropology students. Okay. So, even if the number increases, it will not increase a lot. And second thing, taking anthropology prior to prelims is different thing. Appearing for mains with anthropology as an optional is different thing. So, it depends on how many students from anthropology optional subject clear the prelims. So, you cannot control that figure. If you see 1 lakh students preparing anthropology and 10,000 students preparing history, you may say anthropology will be scaled down. But if only 500 students qualify for mains and 5,000 students from history qualify for mains, then number of history students will be more. Getting my point? You have no control over these factors. You have no control over these factors. But even if you want to explore these doubts, anthropology is safer choice. But I will advise, don't think of these questions while selecting your optional. Don't think of these points while selecting your optionals, because these are not in your hands. I tell you again and again, this is a very responsible statement and advice from me. Don't think of these doubts. Kyoba, scaling down hoega kya, ye mere ko score acha aega kya, pichle saal bahut kam diye the, is saal is subject ko itne kam diye, agli saal anthropology ka number hai kya, agli saal kis subject ka number hai. These are not going to help you. These are not, or this should not be the basis of selection of optional. This should not be the basis of selection of optional. Then on what basis you should select the optional? Your own interest. Your own interest, and if at all you have graduated in that subject. Nothing else, no any other point can be the criteria for your optional. Is study material available? That should not be the criteria for your optional. If study material is not available in Pune, you can go to Delhi and buy the study material. If the coaching is not available in Pune, you can go to Hyderabad, Delhi, Bangalore, anywhere in India, and you can get the coaching. You can overcome these problems. You cannot think of, or you cannot control scaling down and trend of scores. So don't think of these problems. Don't think of other problems which I enumerated a bit earlier, because these points will not matter in your interest in your subject. What is important to select as an optional is your interest. Getting my point? So last word is, while selecting your optional, please follow your own conscience and your own interest. Otherwise, you will land up in problem. 2 months ke baad lagega, yaar scores wagera achhe aate hai sabke, lekin mujhe difficult lag raha hai. I am not finding it interesting. You may say that. So first of all, take some information on that subject. You will get almost 3 to 4 lectures of every subject on internet. Go through those lectures and then make a wise decision. You have time. If you find this subject is very interesting, I can study this, then only go for it. Okay? Will UPSC do away with optional subjects? What happens if I study anthropology this year and if I appear for next exam and next year's exam and UPSC does away with any optional? Then what should I do? Mera time or paisa dono khatam, it will be wasted. To those guys, my answer is, if optional goes next year, you will waste your few thousands of money and 3 to 4 months of preparation. You will waste if this optional subject goes. But what if optional subject does not go? You will waste entire year if you don't prepare it right now. Getting my point? You will entirely lose your next year, which will be of more worth than this year's your fees and your preparation time. Your loss will be greater if you do not prepare this year only. So right now there is anthropology or there is optional subject in your curriculum. You have to prepare it. Baki ka baad mein dekhenge. Okay. So these are my answers to these questions. At the end, I will again reiterate my point. Trend of scores, even if it is highly in favor of anthropology. Trend of scores right now is highly in favor of anthropology. 362 is the highest score scored by a student out of 500. 362 is a huge score. My 4 students or 5 students have got more than 310 marks. More than 310 from last year's batch. There are so many non-selected candidates who have scored very good marks, around 290 or somewhere. So they have scored very good marks in anthropology. In terms of trends of score, anthropology is very good right now. Scaling down, it has not been seen in last 6 to 7 years at all in case of anthropology. Still, I will say, this should not be the basis of selection of optional. You should have interest in your optional. Okay? And that's why I told you what consists of your syllabus. What is in there in your syllabus. That I have explained each and every point. Go through that syllabus again. Think on, will I have interest in this topic? You try to find out lectures on anthropology. There are so many lectures on anthropology on YouTube also. Not entire syllabus has been covered anywhere. But still you will find one or two lectures. I think there is one lecture from me also. On Nandip's YouTube channel. Or you can find Srinivas sir's lecture. Or Susan ma'am's lecture. Or any other lecture by any personnel. On e-Pathshala you will get lot of lectures. So try to attend those lectures and try to find out your interest. Whether you are finding those things interesting. Do the same thing for the subject for which you are having dilemma. If you are thinking whether to go for history or anthropology, then go through some history lectures also. Geography lectures also. Political science lectures also. And then make a wise decision. That is my take on this. Okay. How much time is required to complete the syllabus? It varies there is very huge diversity. Some people take only 3 months for geography. Some people take 8 months for anthropology. There are lot of people with lot of variations. So it depends on your interest. If you are developing interest in your subject, you will finish it in a very small span of time, in a short span of time. There will be no problem. Okay. So that is from my side. Now, your questions are welcome. I am ready to clarify your doubts. If you are having any doubt, please feel free to ask. I will explain. So, out of materials available in the market, Braintree material is the only complete material in terms of coverage of syllabus. In terms of coverage of syllabus. I am not saying in terms of quality or in terms of desirability, but in terms of coverage of syllabus, this is the complete material. Because the material has been designed point wise, 1.1, 1.2, 1.3 up to 1.8, then 2.1, 2.2, 2.3, 2.4, 2.5, 3, 4, 5. These are the chapters and these are the same chapters of our syllabus. Accordingly, that note has been made. That's why I advise students to make that material as the base material. Some chapters are very difficult to understand from Braintree notes. You have to skip that material for those chapters and you have to go for some alternative materials. For example, if you are supposed to study the topic of paleontology So paleontology is very difficult to understand from brain tree notes. So for that, go for Peanut's book. You will get diagrams as well as good study material, good content in Peanut's book. Then there is another chapter on religion or political anthropology or economic anthropology. Those chapters are very easily explained in Maniratnam Reddy's notes. So for that, go for Maniratnam Reddy's material. So I have made that kind of compilation, which point has to be referred from which material. So I am unfortunately not able to give it to you right now, but I will try to circulate it as earlier as possible. Okay. So you have to make it as a base. You cannot find all the chapters very easier in that material. Instead of those chapters, you have to refer the other material. I have explained in that note, you will get it. Or through some other channel or through some other medium, I can share it with you. If you want, you can copy down my number. I can share that material through soft copy also. So ping me on WhatsApp, I will share it to you. That is my study material compilation, which I found useful after 3 to 4 years of study of anthropology. There may be some opinions of differences of opinion regarding study material, but I told you, follow any one man religiously, that study material will be useful to you. One reliable man. You can find them. You can find that reliable man in anyone. It can be a teacher, it can be a topper, it can be your senior who is preparing, anyone. Next. Yes, it is a very important question. Will there be a current affairs question in anthropology? Because political science and public administration may tend to have the questions related to current issues. So in anthropology, current issues are there, which you have to pay attention on. But current affairs is not as such the part of question paper. For example, I'll just tell you, there was a fossil, Australopithecine fossil, 3 to 4 years back it was discovered. Australopithecus Deryameda. I thought that year that this question may be asked in the examination. That question was not asked. This year also there is a yes, that fossil has been discovered. Homo erectus fossil has been discovered in our own India. So even that question is very less likely to be asked in your examination. But you should know a rough idea. On that basis, you may be asked about Homo erectus in your examination. Whatever Homo erectus has been covered in your syllabus, that may be asked in your examination. For example, they may ask you Homo erectus pekinensis, Homo erectus javanicus, or Homo erectus heidelbergensis. That may be asked to you, or Paranthropus may be asked to you. So, accordingly, you have to prepare those topics. Actual newspaper cutting is not to be prepared by you, because that is very less likely, or negligible chances are there that will be asked in your paper, because Deryameda was not asked. Many other fossils which were discovered in meantime were not asked. So current affairs, no, you don't need to prepare. Current issues, yes. So what is current issue then? For example, Maratha agitations were going on in last 2 to 3 years. There were demands for reservation. Not only Marathas in Maharashtra, but Jats in Haryana, then Patidar community in Gujarat, Kapus in Andhra Pradesh, Marathas in Maharashtra. All these castes were demanding reservations in their respective states. This is a current issue. This is a current issue. And in that context, as an anthropologist, you have to explain this phenomenon, or you may have to explain this phenomenon very professional and very scholar manner. You should seem to be a scholar on these kind of issues. Maratha Morchat, kiti lok samil zale, how many people participated in Maratha agitation, and how it created pressure on government and all, that is journalistic study. We are not going to become a journalist. What an anthropologist should try to decipher out of this issue is why the dominant castes in all these states are demanding reservation. So these are not backward castes. Marathas are dominant castes. Marathas are considered as higher in the ladder. Same is the case with Jats. Tujo abhiman asto na Marathyancha, tu tikade Jat lokancha. they are demanding reservation. Patidars, Kapus, they are not backward castes. They are not lower in social hierarchy. And then why they all are demanding reservation? Why they want to claim the lower status in social hierarchy? What are the reasons? So this question should bother you. This question should peep in your mind and you should try to find out the answer. So this is current issue which you should cover. This is current issue, not current affairs. Okay. Or for example, there is study of woman issues, study of woman issues also. So social stratification in paper 1 of society 2.2. There you have to study gender stratification also. There you may have to pay attention on women's issues. So recent years have been in news because of women's issues. Temple entry assail, Nirbhaya case assail, or representation of women in parliament assail. Because of so many issues, gender issues or women's issues have been in news. So you have to be a bit cautious about women's issues. You may not be asked about a specific incidence in anthropology, but you may have to worry about all these issues collectively, and you have to prepare on women's issues that year. So that is, you have to pay on current issues, not on current affairs as such. Got my point? Okay, anyone else? Jale? How many are Marathi? Raise your hands like this. How many of you can't understand Marathi? Okay. And how many of you have made decision to go for anthropology finally? I am going for anthropology. How many are in dilemma with other subjects? Okay. So just overcome this dilemma. I'm not advising you to go only for anthropology or only for other subject, whatever you have in your mind. But make your decision wisely and as earlier as possible so that you will not waste much time in decision making only. Okay. Is there any other doubt or any other question?